This school came into being because of an act that was passed by the colonial legislature in 1723, and it became known as the Free School Act simply because it was to encourage education and also to have facilities where some children could go. Each of the 12 counties in Maryland at that time were authorized to build one school. Anne Arundel immediately followed the regulations of the law by appointing the 7 visitors who had the responsibility of buying property and also employing a builder to construct the school. The 7 visitors were all men, and they were not called Board of Visitors or Board of Education or anything. They were just visitors. One had to be a minister, and the others were basically important people within the county. At that time, Anne Arundel County was quite large because it took in all of the present Howard County, and the school was supposed to be built in a central location. And this is the reason that the school is probably located here. The first schoolmaster here was a gentleman by the name of John Wilmot. He also owned property that adjoined this property. Now the first class, or the first group of children that came here, were all boys. Girls in the early 1700s stayed home and learned how to be homemakers while the boys came to the school. We do not have any idea how many there were in the first class, but Mr. Wilmot, as schoolmaster, also had the right to till the land, and we think sometimes that he probably used the boys to help till the land. He could grow anything on the property except tobacco, and not because it was bad for your health, because in those days they smoked it, they chewed it, but the other farmers around did not want the competition. The school basically in the beginning had a hard time really getting going and keeping the students, because the students were used also to help out at home. When the school was built, there was a loft above the one room, and some of the students actually were boarding students. Of course, as time went on, they built another building here. The third room of this building was a separate building at one time. We think it was used as a keeping room, where they stored their farm implements, and they probably smoked meat there, but it was more or less a storeroom. They were very wise in doing that, because that building was in direct line with the original building. Then in the early 1800s, when there was a demand for more students to come here, they simply joined the 2 buildings together, and they had a 3-room school.
If you look at the size of these 2 rooms alone now, it's not even as large as many of the instructional areas in one classroom now. And to think of putting 65 students in this space that basically is about the size of maybe 1.5 classrooms, 2 classrooms at the most, it would have been pretty full with students.
The golden age was between 1820 and 1830. During that 10 years of time, there were many students that came here, and the largest number that we have any record of, 65 were here. It was not a public school. Each little community took care of their educational needs. And the one-room school was very, very popular. And it was pretty much operated locally by that community. Usually the teacher would be male, the schoolmaster, and in the case of the free school, all of the teachers here were male up until 1853 when the first female teacher came.
They were not allowed to get married. Of course, they were not allowed to be out at a certain time at night. They had to be in it by a certain time.
The term teacher was not used at that time. It was always a schoolmaster. He was probably picked because he was probably one of the most educated, although not college or anything, but he was an educated person, could read and write. If he lived here, he probably came down and started the fires if it was cool and got the candles ready because there was no electricity and had to sweep. The job was the schoolmaster's job, and he had to do everything that there was to do in the school. When the students arrived, he had them, some of them, do things of working and bringing in wood and water because there was no water fountains. They had to go out to the spring and bring in the bucket of water for the day.
The fireplace was not only the source of heat, but on a dreary, cloudy day, that fire would also permit more light to be in certain places. In the wintertime, I am sure that the children who came here enjoyed sitting close to this fireplace. But on a warm day, you would want to sort of back away. You'll see several different utensils here, from the kettle and the pots, and the most interesting thing, the trammel, which permitted the food to be warmed or cooled off simply because there are holes that let you regulate the temperature. The school was not free, even though it always had the name of the free school. You had to pay something to send your youngster here, a chicken or two, or it might have been, you know, some eggs, something that they had in the home. A student had to get here by usually either riding a horse or the horse pulling something. And that is the reason that some of those boys boarded here.
They probably all learned as they could, and probably the older ones helped the younger ones. And the schoolmaster didn't have the large classes. We think they arrived by 8 o'clock in the morning and stayed until 4 o'clock in the afternoon. We had the sandbox where the little ones learned to do their alphabet with someone helping them. We know that they did not have much paper. We know that they had to use slates.
In the early days of the school, when there was no paper, slates were used. This is a homemade slate because slate was readily available around in the community. The father would get some type of drill and get a hole here, put in some type of little carrier, and off to school you would go. And it's rather heavy. Now, if you come to the free school as a student for one of the classes, this is the type of slate, two-sided with a wooden frame around it. And with this slate, we use a slate pencil. Chalk was not readily available either in the early days. But then towards the end of the 1800s, there were slates that were almost like books. because you could open this, you would have two sides here, and then two more sides, which meant that you were not losing everything you put on your slate. You could take it home with you, and you could also do assignments at home with your slate. The book that Estelle is holding is an arithmetic book that dates back to the late 1800s and simply called Rudiments of Arithmetic.
The horn book was something that boys could put in their pockets and carry with them, and it had the alphabet and the Lord's Prayer, so you can see how important religion was to the people.
Inkwells came in various different shapes and sizes. These are two unusual ones, and of course they have the quill pen. There's a collection of bells here. This one is rather clunky, but there are bells that have different tones that go with it. Our most famous alumnus is Johns Hopkins, and he was here from 1806 for 2 or 3 years. He had brothers, and we think that they also came here. Their schooling ended here when their father freed the slaves on the Hopkins farm, and then the boys went home. We have found several indications in writings that the schoolmaster from the free school usually had Saturday night supper with the Hopkins family. And we sort of think that in all probability, he kept the boys going with some type of, you know, schooling.
We do a lesson that's in the 1880s with the students that are come today. And we use some words like night work, which now they call homework. And we have ciphering, which they call arithmetic today. And we have elocution, which they call speaking. And we try to give them a few words that they are not familiar with. And it's an exciting time for children. They really enjoy doing it. And we have a little spelling lesson where we have ads. And I expect almost everybody got that one correct. How did you spell the second ads?
A-D-S.
Did anybody spell it a different way?
A-D-E-S.
Anybody spell it a different way? Nobody is correct. Now I'm going to show you an ads. When you're older and start doing crossword puzzles, you'll know what an ads is. It is a tool, and it's spelled A-D-Z. And it was used for taking the bark off of trees. We've only found one student who really knew what an ads really was as a tool. And they always get the biggest kick out of doing it. We also talk about what they would have to eat if they brought their lunch. And we tell them that they have a sandwich on homemade bread, and that it would be lard on the bread. And if they'd been real good, their mother put baking drippings on it.
A variety of lunch pails. Some of them simply the ingenuity of parents, because this is simply a can with a lid, and in all probability either syrup or tobacco came in this. When it was used, mother simply cleaned it up and had lots of room to maybe put an apple or a sandwich in the lunch pail. And since you walked to school, you could simply go down the road swinging your lunch pail.
You look over there on the shelf. They had a dunce cap.
The dunce cap was one of the sources of discipline. And when children visit here today, they actually will stand in line to try on the dunce cap.
And you wouldn't sit there.
He would be sitting on a stool, probably, in front of the class. And you had to accept the punishment of the schoolmaster, no matter what the schoolmaster said, that you did not say, I'm not going to do that, that you had to do exactly what. But most of the rules were pretty much the same as they are today. Because this was a rather large property, as we know, that they could till and grow things. And there was a little house, this outhouse that they had to go. And it was called the washroom. And they made their little trips back and forth.
Then you'll see more.
A lot of the people who visit, one of the things that they look at frequently when they come are the rules for the teachers, rules for the students. And they do look at that, laugh and enjoy comparing the two. The school was built on the premise of two things, religion, and also to teach the students the skills that they would need in order to go out and get a job.
There was a great need at that time, period of time, for surveyors and navigation procedures and rules. Because if you look at what the economy was at that time, there were still a number of ships that came across and, of course, came to Annapolis and brought various and sundry things. And, of course, there were products here that England also would be glad to get, you know, from the colonies. Over the years, there were periods of time when the school was not open, simply because of finances. And if they didn't have enough students and they didn't have enough sources of money coming in, they didn't have. The school was also not in session during the Revolutionary War. And there was a lady who had a dress shop here, or tailoring shop. So there were other things that were used. The visitors at times even considered, you know, renting the property to some of the local farmers, and probably did in order to have, you know, funds to keep the school going.
Some of the old textbooks that are located here, and many of them are books that have been collected, many of them are books that have been sent to us over the years, and we do keep them and have a collection. We have one book there. It's an old horn book. We do have those. We have some books that date back in the 1800s.
Now, what do you think the kids did for fun?
Tag.
Tag would be one game. What's another game?
Play outside.
Play outside. One of the games was called Annie Over. Have you ever heard of the game Annie Over?
No.
Well, if they had a ball, they could divide into two teams. One team would be in the front of the school, and one would be in the back of the school. And when the team that had the ball would yell, Annie Over, they would throw the ball over the building. This good old jar. Now, if I have a little magic today, I might be able to get this to work. Boys and girls did have toys back in those 1800s. This is a homemade one. Simply a small branch from a tree with notches and a type of little blade that Father could easily make. And basically the whole purpose is to get that little blade to go. The school was really owned by the legislature and was owned even after the school closed until 1911, when it was sold to a family that turned the school into a residence. And they added a second floor, and it really was quite a large home.
Well, it looks sort of modern on the inside, but you have to look at the thickness of the walls and realize that you don't have the standard 3.5 or 6 inch exterior wall. The glass in the building is practically all replaced glass. It's antique glass or reproductions of antique glass, and that's something that we periodically have to replace. The doors are all handmade, especially the back door. They're not typical doors that you would find in a normal structure today. And there's actually a place where you can look at the in the floor, where we can pull up the floor and you can see the original foundation and some of the structure. So even though the only thing that's probably modern with the building is the electrical system that's been installed and the heating and cooling.
The school had three different families that lived here. From once it was sold in 1911 and it was turned into a home. The Van Horns, I think, lived here the longest. And then there was a Mr. Linsky that lived here. But in the mid-1950s, it basically was abandoned. And time, weather, and vandals had a great time with this building. In 1965, there was a lady by the name of Ruth Parker Eason, who, and if you've probably heard that name because the school is named for her, but she was president of the retired teachers. The one-room schools were sold off by the Board of Education to anybody who had the money. So she decided that the retired teachers should save one of these schools. The board got 1.5 acres with the building given back to them, because all of this property had gone through land developers. And then when the Laval group came, they gave 1.5 acres, including the building, back to the Board of Education.
It really means a great deal to them to be able to share it with the community at large. And the Laval community values the building. They use it at least 4 times a year for community activities. And we really enjoy being able to open the building up for students and the community at large. And I think it would be really sad to think that this site would not be preserved as a museum and a monument to that period of time when it would have been such an important part of the community. The reason I think that we all volunteer our time and why the Anne Arundel Retired Teachers Association is so involved with the free school is we really think it has a lot of lessons for people and in general, and specifically for students today. And so it's really a labor of love.